I want you to tap the person sitting near you and tell him, get ready to fight. Tell him again, maybe he didn't hear very well, get ready to fight. And you will fight to the end, and you will win at the end. I welcome you to the church this morning. It's a pleasure to be in the presence of God, to be in a place where we come to be strengthened to face the battles of life. Because it's a battle that we are sure to win. It's a battle we have started. I hope you know that from the day you give your life to Christ, you enlist in the army of the Lord. You are a soldier. And there's a battle to be fought. From the beginning to the end. And this morning, as we sit down and learn together, I trust the Lord that he will strengthen us to win all our battles in the name of Jesus. Amen. Shall we bow our heads as we take a word of prayer? Father, we thank you and we bless your holy name. You have brought us your presence this morning to strengthen us, to fight the end, to finish strong. We are trusting you that you will strengthen our hands, you will strengthen our hearts, that we shall win this battle in the name of Jesus. And at the end, Lord, the glory will be unto you as we share the spoils of war in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'd like us to read 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We take two verses there. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 from verse 24 to 27. It says, do you not know, I'm reading NIV, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way to get that prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get the crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. That is Paul speaking there. The other passage is fairly long, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Just take that down. Now, I'd like to start by saying that everyone who begins a project looks forward to the day where the project will be completed. Every endeavor, you look forward to the day where you complete it. When you get into school, you are looking forward to the day of graduation. Everything that has a beginning should necessarily have an end. And the end should be better than the beginning. When you get into school, the way you go in is not the way you come out. By the time you are going out, you are more educated, you are better informed, you can think better. Everything about you has changed. So, and that's why Ecclesians chapter 7 verse 8 says that the end of a thing is better than the beginning. A lot of people start, but they don't get to finish it. You see projects, you see buildings, you see things, people start that they don't complete. The same way, when we start a Christian journey, there is an end. There is a finishing line. Every race has a finishing line. Whether it's 100 meters, whether it's 120, whether it's 200, even whether it's 26 kilometers, there must be a finishing line. The same way our Christian lives has a beginning from the day we give our lives to Christ, and there is a finishing line. There's an end. But of course, you know that between the beginning and the end, there's a lot of things that happens in between. And it is what a man does after beginning that determines how the end will be. You see people going to school today, when they are getting to school, there's high hopes. They expect, if you ask anyone going to school, going to the university, you would ask him what he expects to come out with, to finish with. I'm sure no one will tell you that he wants to finish with a pass. It's first class. It's first class. But then, it is what you do between the matriculation and the convocation that determines what will happen. So there is some, that center, that middle, is what I want us to look at this morning. Because our Christian race also, we expect to finish strong. And that is the topic of the message this morning, to finish strong. But the truth is that it is not automatic. There are things you need to do when you start to ensure that you finish strong. Just as there are things you need to do 100 level, 200 level, 200 level to ensure that by the time you are getting out of school, yes, you can come out with full confidence. How many people today get into school, but they end up, they will say, it is past they gave me. That one is the day, is they that give. You see people, you see boys or children when they write WAEC and the result come out, and you ask what they do score, what they score in mathematics. They tell you, they gave me P8. it's they that gave. But you hardly hear anyone who comes out with an A in any subject who will tell you that they gave me an A. You won't say that. He worked for it. It's not what they gave him. Now I tell you that in our Christian life also, there's a finishing line. And the thing is that, what are you going to say at the end? Unfortunately, it's not a race that you can end up to say that they gave me. They gave me. You work for it. You labor for it. That is what you are worth. So, in looking at that center, that middle from the beginning to the end, I want to use a verse of the Bible that tells us what to do. Because you see, our Christian life is a life that requires a lot from us. Yes, victory is sure. If somebody puts 10 million naira in the bank for you, you still have to go to the bank to withdraw it. If you don't go to the bank, you could be begging and people will insult you because you have refused to do what you are supposed to do. So when you do what you are supposed to do, that's when you can enjoy what is available unto you. So we'll be looking at 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 to 8. And then we'll pick what the Lord asks us to learn, what wants us to learn in that verse to ensure that we finish strongly. 2 Timothy chapter 4, from verse 6, it says, "For I am ready, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Now this is the statement of Paul the Apostle at the end of his journey. Remember his journey from Acts chapter 9, when he had that encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, and he accepted the free gift of salvation, and then he was commissioned. Now from that point, there were several things that happened along the line. So these few days to the end of his life, he said, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Would it not be wonderful for you, towards the end of your life, for you to say, to call people around you and say, "Look, I have fought the good fight. I have finished my race. I have kept the faith." I want you to imagine how wonderful it will be. How many people get to the end of their lives and they are able to say this? If you listen to, you know, there is hospice services outside the country. Hospice, that is the service to those at the terminal end of their lives. And when you read some of the things that those who are at the end, those who are just at the end of their life, many things that they say, you know that it's not to say, I've finished my course. What most people say is that, I wish I had time. I wish I'd given much more time to important things of life. Because they discover that all that they have pursued all their lives, it amounts to nothing. Some will say, I wish I'd spent more time with my children. Because now, they are at the end of their lives, the children are not bothered. It's somebody else that is attending to them. They cannot even speak to the children. They even call, the child says, he has no time. I read one man, he was just 72. So 10 years ago, he willed his house to the only son, based in the UK, to the only son. But since he's still alive, he's still staying in the house. And then the son just came, just said, he should move to old people's home, that he wants to use the house. He says, send him to the old people's home. And the man was wondering that, see, I built this house with my money. He said, yes, but it now belongs to me. And it became a court case because the son dragged him to the court that the court should compel him to move to old people's homes, that he wants to use the house. He doesn't want everybody to. This is what people labor for. So at the end, just discover that what is the essence of all this? But look at Paul. He said, I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. I'll be looking at each of these statements one after the other. In order to call our hearts to what is important, what is necessary, what is valuable, and what is eternal. I have fought the good fight. What is the good fight? This is the question we need to ask ourselves. What is the good fight? Because it's not all fight that is good. By saying the good fight, he has qualified the fight. It's not all fight that is good. What do people fight for today? For parking space? In the office. This is where I must park my car. And it becomes a serious case. That's what people fight for today. Is that the fight that Apostle Paul is referring to here? What do people fight for today? I'm here on the road. You are coming to put your head. We are going to stay here until the police comes. And nobody is ready to move. That's what people fight for today. What do you fight for today? Is it the good fight? What do you expend your energy on today? What do you struggle for today? Is it the good fight? Paul says, I have fought the good fight. To fight the good fight, you must know how to choose your battles. Today we find families, we find couples, they are fighting, they are struggling on what? I read of somebody who almost killed the wife because of 50 naira. He said, I kept 50 naira on this table, on the bedroom. Where is it? The man said, go and ask the table now. Are you talking to me like that? And that became a serious issue. He said, go and ask the table. It's the table you gave it to. That is what people fight today. Is it the good fight? Is it the good fight? By Paul saying that I fought the good fight, I want you to think about what Paul is making reference to. He's acknowledging the fact that the Christian life is a life where you fight. And brother, sister, you better be ready to fight. I hope you are fighting. What do you fight? What you fight in your Christian life is not demons. It's not your neighbor. It's not your superior in the office. It's not your neighbor, the person sitting by your side. It's not the person near you. What you fight in Christian life is yourself. Is yourself. See, what will stop any man from making heaven is not witches, it's not wizards. It's not the demon. It's not. It's you. Because when you are called into a Christian life, it's a life that demands that you begin to fight the evil propensity, the culture, all those philosophy that stand contrary to the knowledge of God. All rationalizations that make it difficult for you to really serve God. When God gives instruction, all the reasons that rise up in your heart against the instruction of God, that is what you need to fight. Those things that make it difficult for you to obey the Lord. You know that on a normal day, you could stay till 4 p.m. without taking any meal. But the day you tell yourself you are going to fast, what happens? You know, before you wake up, even from the previous night, you already started feeling hungry. That is what you need to fight. You need to fight to serve God, fight to obey God. When we challenge people today that when it's time to come to the church, it's on Sunday that people have time, they oversleep. It's on Sunday people oversleep. I can get to the church at any time. But on Monday, you don't oversleep. It's on Sunday, it's the things of God that there are excuses. You can find one reason or the other to absent yourself, to be careless and be carefree. That is what you need to fight. Fight to serve God. Fight to be a living sacrifice. Fight to give your time to the Lord. Fight to do His will. My sister was talking about a very practical case that God gives instruction. Leave your employment and start a business. But I want you to imagine several reasons that will rise up within you against that plain instruction. You are sure God has told you to do this. You are very sure, there is no doubt. But you need a second confirmation. You need a third confirmation. And you want God to tell you how that business will be, when it will grow, how much it is going to yield before you can forgo this. That is what you need to fight, brother. Fight to take instruction from God and obey it immediately. That is the fight. That is the good fight. It is not to fight demons. It's not to fight your brother or your sister. People today, they can dedicate time, 7 days, 21 days, to go to wherever to pray. But ask, try and find out, what are they praying for? What are they fasting for? People see fasting today as a way to manipulate God or to convince God that what you need to do this for me. But I tell you, you need to ask yourself, what is more important to God concerning your life? Is it to make you a millionaire or to make you holy? Is it to make you a billionaire or to make you holy? What do you think is more important to God? So those are the things you need to fight. Fight to live a life of holiness. Fight to obey God immediately. Fight to be responsive to the instructions of God without argument. All those arguments that rise within you against the knowledge of God, that is what you need to fight. Fight to wake up early in the morning to speak to God. Fight to find time to read the Bible. We have time to do several things today, many things. It is only the things of God that you can delay. You can defer. You can postpone it. There's no time today. You will never get time. You never have time. And you see people today, by coming to the church on Sunday, they think they are doing God a favor. Okay. I have nothing to do. And then sleep till 9 o'clock and wake up and do several other things. And then just saunter, just walk casually into the church. That is what you need to fight. That's what you need to fight. Fight to be a man of God. Fight to follow God. Fight all those evil desires that wars against the soul. Fight to be able to forgive when God tells you to forgive. When somebody offends you and you know you are a Christian, you need to forgive. How easy it is. Those are the things you need to fight. Fight to be a holy person. That is the good fight. So we see the life of Paul. Look at all that he passed through. At a point, he was even beaten. In fact, they left him for dead and just abandoned him. And then he woke up, brushed up again. And then he told the people that we can't get to the kingdom of God without facing such troubles. Brother, even the cost of going to preach the gospel, somebody reports it to the police. You find yourself in the cell, and on the Friday, you cannot go to court. No lawyer. We have lawyers said they cannot get to bail you, and you are sent to the prison till Monday or Tuesday. When you come out, will you go to preach again? Will you join the evangelism again? They're going for evangelism. They're for win some. Win what? Will you join them again? These are the things we need to fight. We need to fight to have a heart that readily obeys God. Forget about yourself. It's unfortunate that Christianity today is we present it as a life of pleasure and indolence and just be gallivanting all over the place. We don't find that in the scripture. So fight. Tap your neighbor, tell him to fight. Fight to be a man of God. Fight to be a woman of God. So this is the type of fighting that Paul is referring to. This is the good fight. That is the good fight. Let's look at the second statement. It says, I have finished the race. Oh, I like that. You enter into a race of 5,000 meters, and then you are going and going and going and going. You know, 5,000 meters is a lot. If you go around the pitch, it's only 400 meters. So if you are running 5,000 meters, you are going 12 and a half times. You are going and going and going. And then at last, you breast the finishing line. Even if you don't win. I watched a race like that. But when they started, that one, I think it was 3,000. That's about four times or so. Six times. So after going around, you know that in my own time, how many people play table tennis here? You play table tennis. Now, yes, Brother Linton, you know if you are playing table tennis, you start 1 point, 2 points. Your opponent is still on four. You have gone, you have reached to 14. You call it 4-4. 4-4 what? There's a name they used to call it during my own time. You say it 4-4 cantab. By the time you say you cantab somebody, that means he's still on four. You have accumulated points. You have gotten to 14. So you call it 4-4, but you say cantab to differentiate your own. So I watched a race like that while they were going around, some opponents, they had gone around already, and they have already cantabbed the others. They already cantabbed them. And they went down. Of course, you know, by that time, you are just running to complete the race. It's not to win anything. So they ran, and then the first, the second, the third, the fourth, but this athlete did not stop. By the time they had finished, they were already giving them flowers. He had not even reached that place. When he got there, he had to go round again. And the man, he continued. Ordinarily, if I was the one, what do you remain? Why waste the energy? But he continued. And she said, lady, she continued. She continued and continued and continued and continued. And at a point, the audience began to appreciate her. So as she was running, they were clapping. They were clapping. They were clapping. They were clapping. In fact, the clapping she received was more than that of the winner. To finish the race, Apostle Paul said, I have finished the race. A Christian life is a race. It's not a 100-meter dash that you can just run. When I see people running long distance now, you know, something comes to my mind. It's fairly established that when it comes to long distance, the Caucasian, that is, these whites, it's not in their blood. You know that even 100 meters, if you look at everyone who has run 100 meters in less than 10 seconds, they are all blacks. There's something different about us. So when they are running long distance and I see any European far ahead Kenyans and Ethiopians and Ugandans, I just laugh at them. Listen, you'll be tired. You will get tired. And usually by the time they are good, some of them maybe 5-10 meters ahead. I say this one. And the Kenyans, you know them, they'll just be following. At a time they'll catch up with them. The race of life, the Christian race, is a long distance race. And one thing about long distance race is that it requires stamina. It requires stamina that is supplied every day. It's not like a boost, that you all receive a boost and then it disappears. It requires stamina. That is why every day you have to be in the presence of God. Every day you are sensitive to the leading of God. Because every day something new, something fresh is coming from the throne of heaven to prepare you for the battle ahead. Paul says, I have finished the race. Telling Timothy that I have finished the race. The race that was given to him. The commission that was given to him. When Paul was called, told him that I've called you specially. I'm sending you to the Gentiles. He got the information, he got the instruction, and he obeyed. And in all his ministry, he focused on what God has given to him. I will say, as we will say today, we will say that he stayed on his lane. He stayed on his own lane. You can only finish well when you stay on your own lane. Once you cross to the other lane, even if you finish first, all the effort will be disqualified. So I ask you this morning, are you on your own lane? Are you doing what God has called you to do? Are you following what God has told you to do? Or are you just copying what they are doing elsewhere? What this man is doing? What this one is doing? Paul says, I have finished the race. His race was to proclaim the gospel to the Gentiles. And in going to the Corinthians, to the Galatians, to the Philippians, it was to fulfill that commission that God had given to him. You need to know what you are called to do. You need to know it. Every man has a purpose. Every woman has a purpose. God will not just create you and just send you to the one and just throw you. Look at your house. Everything you have in your house must have a purpose. So you need to find your purpose and follow the purpose and do what God has called you to do. Paul was a man of one thing, and that's when it's the gospel. Just one thing. He was committed to it. So what are you committed to in the things of God, in the house of God? What are you committed to? What do people know you for? There's no way anyone who met Paul will not know that this person was, this one, his own ministry was completely different. We need to know you for something. And that's why in the church we say that you are not here just to make up the number. You are here for a purpose, for a definite purpose. And it is when you fulfill that purpose that you can say that I have finished the race. Paul finished the race because he knew what was committed to him. And he was getting set to breast the finishing line. He could say, I have finished the race. Now the crown of righteousness is waiting for me. The third statement is that I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. The idea of keeping means preservation, right? When I give you something to keep, it means you should preserve it. Make sure it is not contaminated. Make sure it does not spoil. Preserve it, guide it, and watch over it. So, by Paul saying that I have kept the faith, it means that he has watched over what was commissioned to him, what was given to him. He has preserved it. He has kept it. So the idea is, what was Paul making reference to? You know, Paul had so much encounter with a lot of distraction. In Corinth, people were accusing him that he was not qualified to be an apostle. That because he did not live with he was not part of the immediate disciples of Jesus Christ, that he was not qualified at all. And then the Galatians, Judaizers came, those who began to preach that if anyone was not circumcised, he would not get to the kingdom of God. He had so much opposition everywhere, but he remained faithful. That is the keeping of the faith. He remained faithful. Keeping the faith requires, it demands a love for truth and a commitment to the word of God. Because the word, keeping the faith means that you have a sense of truth. What is proper, what is godly, what God has instructed your heart. But then there are things around you that is contradicting it. How do you stand firm and say, no, this is what I know is true. I live by the truth that I know from the Bible, from the word of God. I serve only God. So many opportunities will come to compromise, you know, to just water it down and just dilute everything and just flow with the crowd because of demands. And, you know, deep within, several arguments will rise that, oh, this one, even God knows that I cannot do it. As what we say that this one, even angels, even if an angel is here, he won't do otherwise. No. Keeping the faith requires that your commitment to the word is unwavering, is unchanging. So Paul said, I have kept the faith. He said, nothing in heaven and earth can take me away from the love of God. Is it death? Is it whatever? Is it nothing? I am committed to him. That is the idea of keeping the faith. Even so, like the example I said that you went out for winsome and you ended up in a police station, you ended up in the prison, and then you are coming out. Keeping the faith means that, yes, the following month, you still go ahead to join winsome, to do winsome. That is how to keep the faith. Because this is what we see in the life of Paul. After he had been beaten, he had been subjected to several beatings, he then said, what can separate us from the love of God? That is how to keep the faith. And that is how to fight to finish strongly. And look at Paul. When he had to confront Felix, he stood before kings and testified to the name of the Lord. He stood before Agrippa and testified to the name of the Lord. All these are in Acts chapter 22. He stood before Festus and testified to the name of the Lord in Acts chapter 25. That is to show that wherever Paul found himself, he was true to what he believed. Bro, if you get opportunity now, and you move to Canada, that's where God is rushing to now, will you still be a Christian? Will you still be a Christian? I learned about somebody who went to Canada, and he said that over there, because of the temperature there, it's difficult to be a Christian. It's very difficult. The temperature is so cold that you begin to wonder, is Christianity based on weather? Is it based on atmosphere? So, Paul, wherever he found himself, he stood firm to the truth of the word of God that is already in his heart, and he lived it out. He testified in the presence of whoever. And that's why he finished strong. And you see, ordinarily, if we ask today that who was the leader of the apostles, we will say Peter, even though Jesus Christ did not appoint any leader. But because in all the three places where we find the list of the apostles, Peter's name was listed first. Maybe that's why people assume. So let's assume, even if it was true. But when Paul got to Galatia, and he saw that before Paul got there, Peter was relating with both the Gentiles and the Jews. Everybody was relating with them freely. But now, when Paul came, he then decided to ignore the Gentiles. I was now relating only with the Jews. And Paul confronted him. Boy, what's happening? This is not what we are taught. That is the boldness that Paul had. And that is the boldness you need wherever truth is being compromised, whoever is doing it. It's not for you to say that, no, this one, I cannot talk. This is why Paul could say that I have kept the faith. Keeping the faith, the truth that God has given to him that he knows, living it and preserving it, making sure that nothing dilutes it. You cannot live a diluted Christian life and finish well. It's like somebody is running. You are running across lines. Because this person is coming after you, you block this one, you block this one. By the time you finish, the judges will tell you, bro, go and sit down. That will not be your case in Jesus' name. So, is to fight. To fight. Paul's faith was faith of victory. And when you fight, and you get to the end, Matthew 25, 21 tells us what Jesus will say. He says, well done, good and faithful servant. That is the response to those who fight to the end. Who fight to the end. Well done, good and faithful servant. So as I conclude, I want to remind you, brethren, that life is a life of battle. But it's not a battle against devil, against demons. It's a battle against your own heart. Against your own heart. Against the culture that brought you up. The culture that is against the scripture, that is against the things of God that you grew up with. The things that wants to hold your heart to ransom from serving God. The ease that your body desires not to trouble yourself when it comes to the things of God. Just take it easy. Just cruise in autopilot. That temptation to only offer to God your spare time when you have nothing to do. Well, okay, nothing to do now. I cannot think about God. Whereas you don't offer your spare time to your employer. Even if you're an employer, you don't take the spare time of your employees. All those things that seeks to choke the truth of God in your heart, that is the fight. One of my buddies, maybe like 2-3 years ago, one of my children sent a message to me that continues to ring in my heart. He says, Dad, I love you because you have taught me to fight harder. Tell the person by your side, tell him, fight harder. Tell him again, fight harder. Fight those things that settle in your heart that make it difficult for you to serve the Lord. Run to win the prize. Run to win the prize. Running talks about exertion. You need to exert yourself. That's why the Bible says that you need to resist the devil. When he's pulling you away, you say, no, I'm not going. You say, no, I'm not going. See, there is what I call the creed of impotence that people try to peddle today. They say, they tell somebody to come to come to the church by 10 o'clock, and you tell, you say, oh, I'm praying for grace. I'm praying for grace. Everything, they are waiting for when grace will come. To come for evening service, they are praying for grace. To read the Bible, they are praying for grace. It's a creed of impotence. I don't know how else to put it. You are looking for excuses. All those excuses are the things you need to fight, that your heart will take action immediately. The Christian life is not a life of indolence, brethren. I want to repeat it. It's not a life of indolence. It's not a life of ease, you know, just pleasure, just go like that. And then it's only when you have nothing to do, you just come and just see friends and just walk away. That is not the Christian life. Even the physical life is not like that. Look at the stress you pass through in school. When it comes to the things of God, is that when anything can go? It talks of exertion, doggedness, intensity. Get back to fulfilling the purpose of God for your life. I've said this several times. I don't mind repeating it, that when you get to heaven, there is no special reward for you because you designed the best building as a civil engineer. There's no special reward. There's no special reward because as a doctor, you saved 1,000 souls if you are not a Christian. You are not born again. There's no reward for it. Yes, you have fed mankind. There's no reward for it in heaven. So get into doing those things that have eternal value. Those things that will give you confidence when you stand before the presence of God that, yes, I've fought the good fight. I've run the race. I have kept the faith. Now I can come for the crown of righteousness. Get involved in those things. Get to live a life of obedience. A life of obedience. A life of obedience. Get to fight that we may finish strongly. Are you ready to fight this morning? Are you ready to fight? Shall we rise up? A life of impact that lasts is a life that wins. And to win, it means you fight. If a person has never fought, you cannot declare him a winner. If you are not in a competition, no matter how good you may think you are, nobody will declare you the winner. Imagine you have somebody, a boy that is very, very brilliant, but he does not register for WAEC. He doesn't register. And then, do you think WAEC will take that because he's brilliant and just give him A's? Or because you are in 100 level, 200 level, you are first class, even half class. And then you live there, and then university just call you and just award you and just say you can. It's not possible. It is when you are in the battle. It is when you are in the competition. That's where you can be declared the winner. If Nigeria does not qualify for World Cup, let's say Brazil is the best, they have the best team in the World Cup, but they don't get to the World Cup, they don't play the World Cup. Who will give them the cup? So, winners are those who participate in the competition and they fight through. You will fight through in the name of Jesus. You will win in the name of Jesus. Amen.